Good evening, everyone. I am Dr. Shavitri Dotto, Coordinator Internal Quality Assurance Cell of Tomda Motichil Rovindra Mahabitalay. First, I convey my warm greetings on behalf of our college to this webinar organized by IQAC. We have with us our principal sir and all honorable IQAC members and participants from different corners from the state and other parts of the country. We are delighted to have you all over here. And I extend my warm welcome to all of you. Your gracious presence is the main motivation and inspiration for us organizing this kind of seminar. Now, today's topic is education in pandemic. In recent months, we have been confronted with an absolutely exceptional situation. In a matter of weeks, coronavirus or COVID-19 has changed how students are educated around the world. And those changes give us a glimpse at how education could change in the long term. Schools and universities have been closed and face-to-face teaching has been replaced by the virtual classes and other forms of distance learning. With the coronavirus spreading rapidly, countries have taken swift and decisive action to mitigate the development of a full-blown pandemic. These risk control decisions have led millions of students into temporary homeschooling kind of situation. And these changes have certainly caused a degree of inconvenience, but they have also prompted new examples of innovative techniques in education. And COVID-19 has become a catalyst for educational institutions worldwide to search for innovative solutions in a relatively short period of time. So how the reactions to COVID-19 will affect education system around the world, and what would be the impact on the trajectory of learning innovations and digitalization, and many questions like this are evolving in our minds. And we will explore this with all these questions with today's speaker, Honorable Dr. Anand Mohan Pal. Dr. Pal is currently professor in the Department of Business Management, University of Calcutta. He has been teaching for past 36 years, 7 years in undergraduate level and 29 years in postgraduate level in UGC full-time teaching on accounting and finance. He is also a member of Senate, University of Calcutta, member of the Faculty Council, University of Calcutta, Chairperson, Undergraduate Board of Studies, University of Calcutta, Convener, PhD Research Advisory Committee. He was former head of the department, Calcutta University, and Director, MBA, HRD course, CU. Six of his scholars have been awarded PhD and 8 are continuing. Dr. Pal has more than 30 edited books and journals and study materials and at national and international levels. He has presented his paper in more than 50 national and international conferences in India, China, USA, and other countries. He has delivered various keynote addresses, session chair addresses, invited lectures, refresher course lecture, orientation course lecture, continuing professional educational lecture, and webinar lecture for professional courses. He has completed projects on forest accounting, UGC projects on accounting environmental taxes in India, global market for emission trading, and global market for emission trading. So Dr. Pal is member of ICAI, IAAA, IAA Research Foundation, and Bengal Economic Association. So we are all now eagerly waiting to listen from Dr. Pal and getting enlightened and enriched. So please, over to Dr. Pal.
Well, thank you. Very good evening to all of you present there and virtually present in this seminar. And some are attending from very home environment, taking some food and resting on the bed. I can see because camera is on. I can see Aniruddha Sarkar is taking evening snacks. And okay, in this situation, this pandemic, we are suffering all. And And now I thought that this education, we have person involved in education. Education is a hugely affected sector. So I am not, my subject is not education, but all of us are involved in education, because I am as a teacher or as a student, our world is in the world of education. So now this time is limited, so I have some time. So I start my presentation. I had prepared something to show you. So if you please see this, whether you can see this one. Education in pandemic. Just one answer or respond. I would understand that it is visible to you.
Yes, visible, sir.
Okay. Then now I would start from global magnitude. That what is this problem? You know, after this 3 and 3.5 months, it is known to everybody that what is this pandemic, what is this COVID-19. All these things are, I am not talking again, repeating again, but our focus is on education. And we know this pandemic has shattered economies around the world. This is global magnitude I am talking now. It has also battered education system in my country, in other countries, in all the most of the developing and developed countries. All developed and developing countries and underdeveloped countries also are severely affected by this pandemic. Their economies are shattered and their education sector is also equally battered. You see, some 1.5 billion students, 1.5 billion students, that means 150 crore students, that is close to 90% of all primary, secondary and tertiary learners in the world, are no longer able to physically go to school. That is the problem. 90% of the students, and their magnitude I am mentioning here, what is the volume? Volume is 1.5 billion, that means 150 crores. So many students, they are not able to physically go to school. The pandemic has forced universities to bring their courses online. So how they are responding due to this pandemic? What is the response? Forced universities to bring their courses online. That is from the point of universities, and it is true for some schools also, because the schools have no other option. The schools or colleges for which these online courses can be offered, they have taken recourse of that. We can expect a new model to emerge once COVID-19 has passed, and that is our. It is in the process that after COVID-19, after all this pandemic is over, after this pandemic, we may find some new model in education to emerge. Now, the question, can traditional campus-based universities, schools and colleges adapt by choosing the right technologies and approaches for educating and engaging their students? That means this point, it means that we are at the traditional setup. Whether it would be possible or what time it would take to make us able to adapt right technologies and approaches for meeting the need of the students. Now, these issues are not our country's particular issues. These are the global issues. These statements are equally shared by the thinkers in US and in Europe and in Australia. They are also thinking in this way. Now, this traditional versus online education, the cost of higher education has been skyrocketing. It is increasing at a very fast rate. Education has to be transformed, changed, so that higher education, which more people will need in an automated world, becomes more affordable and more accessible. Because nowadays, at present, what education is continuing, what this traditional mode, existing mode, that is highly costly. And already people, students, community were thinking that how to reduce the cost, more affordable and more accessible. So that was the position, that was the condition. The new generation of digital technologies, such as mobile, laptop, cloud computing, machine learning, etc., these things have already matured. So personalized education can be provided online at scale, at huge quantity, at a much lower cost than that of conventional education. In conventional education, due to physical presence or this huge infrastructure, what cost is involved in online education, that can be reduced. That is the thinking, not in our country only, our country, a part of our country is thinking in that way, but in US, in Europe, they are thinking in this line. The current forced experiment, I am coming to this online education, but before that I am just telling you. The current forced experiment, this experiment of online education is now forced because we are compelled to go online in certain cases. This forced experiment with online instruction has significantly lowered the psychological barriers to change among parents, students, faculty, and university leaders. Because there was certain psychological barriers, true. Because we are thinking, we are all the time hesitating that whether we should go for this online technology, technological based education, to that extent we should go or not. And for that, now we are forced, without much thinking, without taking much time, we have changed. Many colleges, universities, schools have changed to online education. Now we see that what is that? Right now, we see video conferencing apps like Zoom, this Google Meet, WebEx, are throwing universities a lifeline. Universities, colleges are using them for serving their own purpose, for their continuing their own activities. However, lecturers are still struggling to maintain the same depth of engagement, involvement with the students they could have in a classroom teaching. Because in a classroom teaching, in what way we can interact in this e-mode, in this remote teaching mode, it is still difficult for the teachers. While this online segment still comprising a small fraction, you know, that while we are talking about this online education, this 2.2 trillion global higher education market, if you measure that as $2.2 trillion market, and what is the segment of online education? Online segment is only, it is less than 2%. You see that online education, we are talking about that. That is the only escape now from the in the present condition. Still, even it is the record of from the taken from the advanced countries, and that is global record. So 2.2 trillion global higher education market, out of that only it is less than 2% that is occupied by this online segment. Now I am coming to one statement made by Kenneth Hartman 14 years ago. That Kenneth, educational leader Kenneth Hartman, wrote in an op-ed titled "Op-ed means in one article on the newspaper, giving his opinion. What was that? Schools must learn to use the internet to quickly recover from a disaster. 14 years back, he has written that from a disaster to recover, they should learn to use internet. What I had written that, he imagined the disaster taking the form of a pandemic, a scenario that now appears tragically prophetic. Well, now we understand that it is, this pandemic is the disaster, and in that disaster, we have no option but to use online as much as possible. Now I am coming to problems on online education. Although online education is, we are taking recourse of, we are going for online education in this scenario, but online education does not enjoy a stellar reputation, full of reputation, not that. Persistent problems include low completion rates in open enrollment programs. That means whatever enrollment programs in online, it is introduced, 100 joined that programs, out of that, however, it may be found that only 30 or 35 have completed that. Others have lost interest in it or have not completed. These online programs, whenever someone enrolled it is found the completion rates are very low. Bored students, that is, students feel bored on this online education. From the computer, they would read materials and then answer it and read materials. There is no interaction with teachers, no, with friends, with no discussion. Cheating on exam. What happens? They all the time take that advantage of using some other unfair means to give the answers online. Nobody is seeing, and anyhow, answers are managed. And these kind of things, problems are there. And widespread reports of unconnected students. Students could not be connected. Poorly prepared instructors. Instructors are not prepared. And this then Zoom bombing. You know, using Zoom, there are certain hacking or other types of problems coming. So this kind of risk are there. And lastly, you see some Bloomberg Business Week has warning given by them that 70% of America's 1.5 million faculty members have never taught a virtual course. They have taken that statistic. And in America, it has been shown in Bloomberg Business Week, it has been reported that 70% of America's 1.5 million faculty members have never taught a virtual course. So if it is the condition for America, then what would be the condition for India? That is quite predictable. The teaching would also be a problem, not only on the student side, on the teacher side, there would be also a problem. Now I'm coming to China for certain references. China established what they did, some other countries, what they did to respond to this pandemic on education. Pandemic shock on education. China established a national cloud clearing platform, cloud learning platform, providing study materials for all students at the junior and senior high school levels. So they had provided this to all schools, junior and senior high level school. With this, after this started the pandemic, they have within 2 or 3 weeks they have completed this cloud learning platform they have developed nationally. They have also incorporated public broadcast learning into their domestic education strategy with dedicated public TV channels airing primary school class materials. So classes are taken through TV channels. In our country also this is taking place to some extent, but they have introduced it in large scale so that it can reach, education teaching can reach to the students where physical presence is not possible. Major Chinese telecommunication companies like China Mobile, China Unicorn, and China Telecom combined efforts with technological giants, Baidu, Alibaba, and Huawei to bolster the digital learning network with 7,000 dedicated servers, 7,000 dedicated servers, and 90 terabytes of bandwidth. So huge capacity they have developed. We should learn this. We should take this idea. If I say that, okay, we also use network, the students should also use all internet facilities, but whenever internet connection is taken, but there is no bandwidth, and you are not ultimately getting, instead of say 40 megabyte, you are getting 0.4 megabyte and disconnected after 5 minutes, after 4 minutes. In this way, if it goes, there is, even if schools and colleges tries for online teaching, it would not be successful. So facilities should be created by whom? By the industry, by the government. China had already done it. It is not their proposal that they would be doing this in future. They have already done in the first month, they have already done it. In the first month of their lockdown period, they have already completed this. They report that after completion. And we always, in our country, we did it. We report everything before even installing the stepping, the first step. Even the first step is done, we report everything that this is our plan. We would be doing this in 10 years, in 20 years. This education, our education policy to make everybody literate, that was our plan within, in our, after independence, it was stated that within how many years? Within 5 years, all Indians should be, that literacy should be completed. It was planned. 5 years gone, 50 years gone, and that target is not yet fulfilled. Now, I'm coming to next. We have also, it is not our country, it is not also China, it is American. Wide open school. Wide open school is, I'm stating something, that Common Sense Media is one big institute, unit. In COVID-19 related crisis, they have some combating efforts. In that effort, they established this wide open school, a free online resource powered by the support of over 25 organizations. Wide open schools collecting of learning experience cover all major scholastic subjects for teachers and students alike, while connecting families with programs offering affordable internet and low-cost technology assistance. So they are taking the charge, the responsibility to reach the family, to reach the students, and with affordable cost, and provide resources for the teachers and for the students. And that is free. That is done by different organizations collectively. And it is named as Wide Open School. And then this traditional in-person classroom learning is likely not going away entirely, that is this physical mode learning, but the opportunity for heightened virtual solutions complementing that in-class experience will be expanded, will be furthered with the arrival of 5G technology. New 5th generation technology would assist in complementary, giving these complementary services to the class teaching by way of remote teaching. This digital divide, what is this concept, digital divide? Digital divide is for this, all these online courses, it is based digital. It is digital teaching, suppose, digital education. Now, in our country, many of us are unable to get access into this digital mode, and others are getting access to this mode. So if education is provided through digital mode, then a section of our society would be unable to access this education. So there would be a division. Those who have got this opportunity of digital education and who are not getting this opportunity of digital education. In that way, the students would be divided. One students will have students, they have digital, and one student who is have not, in the group of have not, they have not that digital advantage. So it is in our country we think, but now I am showing that in world, entire world, what is the position? More than 4.5 billion people currently use the internet, but that is still only 60% of the world's population. This gap between countries and socioeconomic equity must change if we are to broaden the viability of virtual learning. So virtual learning is possible for all when this 60% would be raised to almost near 100%. If that can be raised, only then we can avoid digital divide. Otherwise, those 40% who are not getting this internet facility would be deprived of the education. Education would be not coming to them. We cannot, but in our country, education is a right. So it has to be done. Now I am coming to our country. First, I am showing national magnitude. That I can get the records of 2017 statistics, MHRD statistics. And after 2017, it would increase further. But in India, what is the statistics number of students in 2017? School students, 29 crores, more than 29 crores. And higher education, 14 crores. As for higher education means college and university. As per MHRD statistics. Total 43.6 crores. This is the volume. And they are now for these 3 months, they are not getting, the education has been to some extent stopped. They are not getting the opportunity of going to the class. India has 14 lakh schools, 20.1 lakh children enrolled in government schools for class 1 to 8. An additional 38 lakh children enrolled for 9-10, according to another report, School Education of India. Approximately 29% of India's population are children, and 19.29% is in the age group of 6 to 14 years. This group is legally entitled to education under the Right to Education Act. So in our country, under Right to Education Act, these 19.29% of our population in the age of 6 to 14 years, they have right to education. So the country cannot adopt one education policy, education mode, which may not reach this 19.29%. Suppose out of this 19.29%, only 12% has been reached. And another 7.29% is not reached because of the internet connection is not there, this cannot be done, because they have the right, all that those who are deprived, who are not getting the internet facility, they have also right to education. So education arrangement, all this management must be done, administration must be done in that way that it can be reached. They can be reached. Sometime in the second week of March, we know state governments across the country began shutting down schools and colleges temporarily as a measure to contain the spread of the novel coronavirus. It is close to 4 months, and there is now, it is almost more than 3.5 months, and there is no certainty when they will reopen. It was a crucial time for education sector. Board examination, nursery school admissions, entrance tests of various universities and competitive examinations, among others, are held during this period, and this period is lost. Tunnel means we are in some dark passage opening. Where it would open, we do not know. That is called tunnel. We are now feeling a tunnel feeling, we are now all the time feeling. As the days pass by with no immediate solution to stop the outbreak of COVID-19, school and university closures will not only have a short-term impact on the continuity of learning for more than 40 crores young learners in India, but also engender far-reaching economic and social consequences. Not only the school days are lost, but it has far-reaching consequences. The structure of schooling, learning, including teaching and assessment methodology. Someone could mute.
Participants are requested to please mute themselves. Mute yourself, please. There is a lot of background noise, please. Please mute yourself. Okay, sir.
Well, only a handful of private schools could adopt online teaching methods. Their low-income private and government school counterparts, that is the low-income private schools and government schools, on the other hand, actually have completely shut down for not having access to e-learning solutions. They have to shut down. Some handful of some private schools could adopt online teaching. And then students, they are also suffering in what way? They are not getting classes. Then what happens? The students, in addition to the missed opportunities for learning, no longer have access to midday meals, the school students, midday meals during this time. And they are also subject to other economic and social stress with their families. Then the caution, the pandemic has transformed the centuries-old talk-and-talk teaching model to one driven by technology. So now education, whatever we can think of, that can be continued in this social distancing mode that is only driven by technology. This disruption in the delivery of education is pushing policymakers to figure out how to ensure inclusive e-learning solutions. Inclusive means there should not be outsiders. All the students should be included therein. so that the digital divide can be tackled. Digital divide means because of this online mode, because of this technological use, some are not getting access and others are getting access. In that way, if that division is created, that division should not be allowed. Then we think. This, when schools and colleges open, what would be, what is thought of by our minister mentioned that modified seating arrangements, change in timings, further division of the class into different sections, because distance should be maintained, so modified seating arrangement. Changing timings means that what are the hours of classes, the timing, school timing, that should be changed. Two slots, three slots timing should be there. Further division of the class into different sections. One class with 30 students would be divided into three classes, three sections of 10 students each. In that way, it has to be done. Now think. These are stated by the minister, but the arrangement, facilities, structures, infrastructures, these are not up to the standard. One room is not there. How can be there three rooms for one class? So those arrangements, what we say, we are only say that it should be done in future. It should be done in future, but that is very difficult thing to actually implement. So what I think that it may be possible that a number of students would not get the facility of all this coming to the classes, etc. Because of this lack of the school rooms, school buildings, or timing, whatever it may be, it would not be possible to cater these facilities to all the students. Only a section of the students may avail this, others may not. And I think it can be done in this way, that there should be some online mode and there should be some physical mode, when both should be complementary. That means to some extent, suppose 50% of the courses would be done online, and 50% of the courses would be done on the physical mode. In that way, the entire workload would be divided. And when this 50% of workload is taken by physical mode, then it may be possible to arrange classes, because the hours, required hours would be far less. 50%, half would be the required hours. And when half would be the required hours, that can be distributed over the day at different time slots to attend different group of students. Now, NCERT is doing something. What they have done in this, because for the school education, NCERT, and for higher education, UGC is there. Social distancing needs to be maintained, not only during classes, but also during transport facilities. They have told, NCERT has explained. It is quite possible that classes would be able to incapacitate only 30% of students. It is stated by the minister on behalf of the NCERT. The minister stated that what they have thought, that it is quite possible that classes would be able to incapacitate only 30% of the students they used to have before coronavirus. So class would be taking only 30% of the students. That means for covering 100%, it would require three periods, because at one class, if out of 100, 30 can be accommodated. So to accommodate all the 100 students, to give service to education to all the 100 students, you need three classes or more than three classes at least. So that is the thing NCERT has only stated. So nothing specific has yet been stated by the NCERT. Only some suggestion. How it would be implemented, there is no such direction. While UGC is working out the modalities for higher education institutes, including colleges and universities, for the upcoming session, the minister said, UGC is working out, not has done anything. It is still thinking what to be done. Schools and colleges have been shut since mid-March, and teachers have been asked to tutor from home using online mode. The minister said, I have taken some statements from the minister. He asked teachers to continue online teaching through various modes, including teachers are using Swayam Prabha, Diksha. The ministers also asked teachers to contribute to the interactive, innovative ways of digital learning for Diksha's portal. He informed that so far over 9,000 contributions have been received by the HRD ministry. Diksha portal should be enriched by this innovative teaching contribution. Now, regarding when we find the end of the tunnel. While the UGC has stated that classes for enrolled students will begin in August, that is, who have done their second semester, completed or doing their second semester, their third semester class will open in August as per declaration of UGC. And phase batch students who will be admitted to the first year or first semester, their class would begin from September. That direction is given by the UGC. But there is no clarity on when school will reopen. Regarding opening of school, we have not sure where it would be. In India also, the Central Board of Secondary Education's chairman, Karwal, she said, technology without equity will not lead to effective learning in all our children. Their equity should be taken care of. That equity means that everybody has a right and fulfillment of their right. Everybody means all the children of our country, whether poor or rich, whether they have facility are there or not, they have right. And technology, if technology is provided only to those who have, and technology could not be provided because of some poverty, the technology is not reaching the poor people, but technology is reaching the rich people, in that case, equity is not maintained. So, Karwal said, we are now trying to realign the whole learning process, the pedagogy, that is, the instructional process, children will be called to school. Regarding schools, how they will be called to school, that is one big issue, because after 3 months, 4 months, absence from school, and they are also mentally, to some extent, some pressure on them. So when they would come to school, right at that moment, classes should not start with the study material. They should be allowed to open their mind, unwind their stress, and then after some time, regular classes should start. Anything someone's
Somebody's microphone is on. Please mute yourself. Participants are requested to please mute yourself.
Well,
sir, you continue, please.
I am coming to the next regarding teachers' condition. I am giving you some information what I come across while studying these things. That India's school education system includes 10,93,166 contractual teachers at the elementary level. These teachers in many states like Bihar and Delhi were not receiving their salary for several months. teachers in small private school have lost their jobs, and contract teachers in government are afraid of being thrown out. Many of them have not been paid for several months. That is already stated. There have been reports of former teachers lining up for Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, whatever it has been there, that Mahatma Gandhi Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme. In that scheme, they have actually gone, those teachers. There have been reports of former teachers lining up there. So this is the condition of the teachers community during this pandemic. This pandemic is not only affecting students, the teachers are also hugely suffering for that. Now, this marginalized children of our country, it is quite ironic that substantial portion of the discussion on education today are about online learning and the pros and cons of it. There are little discussion or debate about the impact of school closures on the most marginalized and poor children. That has been not very much discussed or thought of or taken any care for that. India's multi-layered society, this point I need to explain. India is a multi-layered society. Now, this India's multi-layered society has always needed a strong public education system incorporating a holistic vision to achieve universalization of education while also establishing a discrimination-free education system. No discrimination for girls or other religion, etc. However, this didn't receive adequate attention from the policy makers. And now the pandemic has magnified the inequalities. Inequalities have been magnified due to this pandemic like never before. Again, I am coming to mid-day schemes for certain data. Schools are more than learning centers for poor children. It is not only their learning center. They provide social protection. Number one, social protection is actually provided through this school education. Otherwise, there would be some other danger also. They provide social protection, nutrition, health, and emotional support to the most disadvantaged. And this applies in all countries, from low to high income. Now, point, about 1.2 crore Indian children are not receiving their midday meal during school closure. These meals serve as an important safety measure, as economists estimate that 75% of poor families' income is spent on food. So, latent emphasis on technology-driven education put many children in this country from continuing school education. That is very grave issue for us. Now, before coming to this, I am pointing out another thing, that besides infrastructural challenges, India is a diverse and multilingual country. Various dialects, various contexts, and diverse life experience are what a classroom in India brings together. The One Nation, One Channel digital framework needs to be reconceptualized, and that here I have pointed out that if the new normal becomes the norm, the policy will need to situate what? Number one, equity, number two, inclusion, and number three, diversity in the new frame of things. A one nation, one channel, one digital framework will not be able to translate the goal set by this draft national education policy into action. This draft national education policy whatever this policy should be fulfilled by equity, inclusion, and diversity, but that cannot be attained if only we go for one nation, one channel, and one digital framework. That may not allow diversity, may not ensure inclusion and equity. Further, we should also create barriers to India achieving the Sustainable Development Goals, SDG 4. SDG 4, what it states on quality education, which now ever more than before needs to be looked at. Because quality education, for quality education, we have to ensure quality education to attain this Sustainable Development Goal. Now, last, I'm coming the last part, where Nandan Nilekani, you know Nandan Nilekani, the co-founder of Infosys, I would say something about that. While praising the government's Diksha platform has been developed, Nandan Nilekani said that key stakeholders in the education sector need to keep innovating. Innovation is that he had given certain idea. I'll be discussing that. He was asked that during lockdown, how education can be delivered during lockdown to households that don't have access to smartphone or feature phone. Infosys co-founder stated that digital service center could become an enabler in the present situation. So he said that what? Digital service center should be opened in the villages, remote places. We have to use our physical infrastructure. People may not have a device, may not have that laptop, may not have that modern, smart mobile, but they could be close to a digital and from that digital service center, they would get this online services. Again, the last word, last slide, that from Nilekani, what he said, that there is a certain inherent role of teacher. That doesn't mean that this online education teacher would vanish. Inherent role of a teacher in education that cannot be taken away. The teacher plays an important role in gauging the learning and receptivity of the child. That to what extent a child learned or understood, that should be assessed by the teacher. The mentorship role played by the teacher will be crucial in this time. Ultimately, teacher is must. Thank you for question hearing. Yes, thank you all.
Sabitridi. Thank you, Dr. Pal, for such a wonderful and informative session. It has been really a very insightful session for all of us, and we have come across new knowledge on education system in this crisis days and the related areas, and I am sure that this is really this would really benefit all of us present over here and enhance our knowledge in the area. So I would request Dr. Pal to take a few quick questions. I would request the participants, please put your questions in the comment box, the chat box, or you can unmute yourself and ask sir the question directly.
From chat box I can see it. Chat box is.
Please, yes. if you have any question.
Any question on the chat box, I would answer it.
No, it.
Is there anything in chat
as of
box?
No, there is no question. I can't see any question. Participants are requested that if you have any question, then please unmute yourself and ask the question directly.
How can our traditional education system survive? Yes, traditional education system, conventional education system, where teachers and students will interact, will talk, will understand one another, and in that way, the teachers would motivate the students to learn more. that kind of teaching would be there, but it would not be 100%. So far, what is supposed 100 hours teaching hours are there, out of 100 hours teaching, suppose my idea is that 70 or 80 hours would be on online, but 20 or 30 hours would be left for personal interaction. That kind of thing would be there. And as a result, that capacity, whatever college or school building capacity are there, when I need to accommodate, suppose in one class 60 students, when I am devoting 100% of study material, study things, I have to discuss with them. So in 1 hour, I have to face 100 students or 60 students. Now I will be facing only 10 students or 15 students, because my actually the coverage, 80% coverage is already done through online mode that has been taught, only 20% question answer session. Just like this, suppose this session, this interaction session, it could have been arranged in some with certain physical presence at one time, then you would all put your questions, I would answer that. And it would take only, suppose, 10 minutes out of 60 minutes. 60 minutes total, I am not before you. Only 50 minutes, I am on online mode. Only for 10 minutes, I am coming close to you. And in that, we are coming close to one another in physical mode. In that way, the conventional education would be there up to 20% or 30% of the total course material or total course plan, and 70% or 80% would be going for the online mode. That would be the future education education process I can understand so far.
So there is another question, that country like India is really ready for digital mode of classroom?
Never. They are not even ready to complete their conventional method. You are under conventional method. Can you say that it is already 100% they have reached? Literacy is full. All children are getting education. All the higher education, all are getting the access to the education. They are not getting. Even in the conventional, if it is continued, if there is no pandemic, even then there is 40% who are losers. So after this pandemic, when online, how one can ensure that these facilities would be there? I'm sure their facility would be there when it would come, but within 2 years, it is not possible. Within 2 years, it is not possible to reach even 80% of the students. Forget about the rest 20%. Even 80% of the students cannot be reached through the infrastructure so that they can get access. Only suppose 50% or 40% may have get access for the private schools, certain or limited schools with huge cost, they could manage this. But whatever saying that free education for all the poor and poverty-stricken children, free education would be there, but that would not be implemented, as it needs certain devices on the part of the students who have no food, how they can manage one mobile or laptop. So in our country, we cannot plan that each student will get one laptop. That policy we cannot take, but in other countries they have taken, they have that resources, they have taken. We have not that resources. I do not know whether we have resources or not, but that would not be, it is not possible so far I can understand. Any other question?
Yes, sir. There is another question that, sir, don't you think that online education with television is more beneficial and more effective for school students?
Yes, always. I think television mode, laptop, all these modes are very much beneficial, but those should be supplementary or complementary in addition to the offline teaching, in addition to the physical mode teaching. Whatever minimum physical mode teaching must be there. Teachers and students must interact in the classroom. The classroom teaching, I am not against, not never, I would say that classroom teaching would be totally abolished, totally withdrawn. That cannot be done. And all this TV mode, that would be additional. In class, suppose in my class, I always give some videos to my students. Some video classes are there, available. in international all websites for America, from Europe, from Canada. I'm getting those videos, and I supply those videos to the students, the class lectures, very advanced class lectures. But I give certain introduction so that they can understand these preliminary things. I just give them idea, and then they can use that video. So that would be always helpful to them for growing their insight for advanced knowledges.
The next question is, what will be immediate measures to solve the problems in education in pandemic situation?
What would be the immediate measure? You see, already 3 months, 4 months gone, and then you are asking what would be the immediate measure. No immediate measure has been taken by anybody. Everybody, the authorities are thinking what to be done. I already told UGC, NCERT, they are working out. They are preparing what to be done. They have not given any decision. In our state government, in the exam system, evaluation system, some order has been passed recently that, okay, in that way, last year exam results should be carried forward for 80%. In that way, some, but that is not solution. That is, by any way, continuing this in this situation so that the students are not hugely sufferers, to get them promoted to the next classes. All these helps are given, and there it is mentioned, the highest percentage that he or she has got in the last semesters, that should be carried forward, whatever highest percentage. That is to give maximum advantage to the students, because they are going to be the losers for all this pandemic. But there is no solution. Solution is a far-reaching thing. That is not their immediate solution. And I am not seeing any clear solution, because online is still a remote, not instant, not ready. It would take certain time in our country for online education. Then any other question, please?
Yes, sir. Can you share your view regarding the evaluation process? What should be the process in this crisis?
Actually, if it is really online examination, then the evaluation process is quite reliable. But online examinations are not, this arrangement is not there. Now my students are in other countries. From them, I know that they are taking online examinations. The questions are given by the university, by the colleges. Questions are given on online mode. They are giving answer. That answer is all the time in the system. They have recorded it. 1 hour, 2 hour examination is being held, and that record is already going and assessed by the teachers. My students are teachers. They are assessing from whatever online answers they have got. Afterwards, they got the copies and they evaluated. So that would be done, but that takes certain time. We have no infrastructure for that. So nowadays, what is done? That I give certain questions to them, and they are answering that and giving that through mail, through WhatsApp, and evaluating that. But that is not in that way reliable, because anybody can copy that or take some unfair means to give the answer. What is the reliability of that answer? So in that way, we are doing now temporarily, but that is not one evaluation process. So in that way, now there is no readily online evaluation would be done when online infrastructure would be installed. Okay.
The next question is, sir, the remote area student, how they can continue this kind of online education system in near future? Is there any model of education as per your suggestion?
No, there is no model. I told Neelakani, you had mentioned that there would be some centers. Centers should be there. Centers means that Neelakani, what centers he mentioned, that this online service centers would be established in different villages. There is certain school. Suppose school is at 1 or 2 kilometer distance, but in the every villages within short distance, some service center should be there. In that service center, some laptop, some TV, and some digital, all these digital devices should be maintained, not for every family, because there may be 50 families. For 50 families, 50 device cannot be given by the government. But for 50 family, one device can be allotted. And that one device can be accessed by other students in from that 50-person community. They can access that one device, and that has been, that idea has been given, and that has been practiced in Himachal Pradesh. I do not know. He mentioned that in Himachal Pradesh, they are doing this, because in remote areas, they have, it is not possible to give every family one laptop or one device, but they are giving to the service centers. They are opening in the service centers, just like schools, branch of school. And in that service center, these facilities provided. In that way, something can be done. Some big investment on the part of the government is required. Big investment in form of this device and in form of bandwidth. You have to increase bandwidth, that internet connectivity is there. Because even if you get device, if internet connection is not there, no use of that. So electricity, internet connection, all these things, all these infrastructural facilities should be provided to the remote areas. Unless those are provided, no use of this online education today.
There is a question that how will this pandemic threaten the achievement of the ambitious sustainable development goals in India? In what way the stakeholders are responding in that front?
I cannot, which question is there? I cannot get that. Let me.
Sir, I'm repeating. How will this pandemic threaten the achievement of the ambitious sustainable development goals in India? In that way, in what way the stakeholders are responding in that front?
Well, so far my answer would be a bit satirical, because our goal has never changed. We are maintaining that goal that within 10 years we will be one of the big five, one of the big six. Goal is remaining same, but how to reach that goal, there is no roadmap regarding that. Whenever you ask what is the roadmap for reaching that goal, then you will get no roadmap. So the roadmap goal is not affected, but roadmap, if it was there, then that roadmap would have been affected. But there is no such roadmap there. So there is effect, huge influence, but the goal is, we are putting that goal as if everything good is in our goal. How to reach that level, sustainable, that roadmap is never clearly stated. And for that reason, you would not find anything that in what way it would influence your roadmap. That roadmap is most important in this case, not the goal. Goal can be reached, you have to change your path of achieving it. But if one path was already there, then you have to change it. If no path is there, you need not change it. You keep that goal, and whatever condition is going on, we are suffering.
The next one is, sir, in case of virtual teaching learning, syllabus may be completed, but do you think that physical health of students will be maintained? What about their mental health?
Do you think physical
health of students will be maintained? And what about their mental health?
Yes, mental health would be adversely affected for both the teachers and for the students, because teachers also feel very much, active, effective only when they are with the students. Just like one good, suppose on the stage, when he starts to play something, then he is very much feeling very much strong. And after coming down from the stage, he is feeling weak. The teachers are like that. When they are with the students in the class, they are feeling everything. They are also motivated to do something. And when that interaction with the students are missing, the teachers also would be losing their motivation and focus. And the students also, they are also motivated, and they have got something from the teachers that motivate themselves to learn more, for more understanding. And also their friends. When in a class the students are sitting, they have friends they interact with them, everything when gone, their mentally would be very much negatively affected, and how that can be made up, how that can be reduced. I have not thought about that. It is not there. I have not found anything. Everybody said that should be done. It should be reduced. But why, in what way? What is the process? That has never stated. Nobody has thought about it internationally, not in our country. Internationally, that has not been done.
The next question is, how will we motivate our students in this pandemic situation through digital mode?
Digital mode, they are motivated. Rather, from the students, we need to learn, because they are more capable of using all these things. And so they are motivated. I whenever I meet my students in Google Meet, many times I call that you organize the meeting and I will be participating there. Instead of I am hosting, they are hosting things. And I do that because they can organize it and they are already motivated to do that. But problem is, someone has no mobile, no smart mobile, he is not participating or she is not participating. How I can reach that particular student? Out of suppose 20, one is missing the mobile, and that creates the problem, because one class is a chain. The weakest person is the maximum strength of that chain. Any chain, the weakest ring is the maximum strength of that entire chain. So if in my class one student is there who doesn't understand suppose English, in that case, for all the students, I have to change my language so that they can, that individual one student can understand. So here is the problem, that majority students now, our college students in Kolkata metropolitan city, most of them uses mobile phone and they can use this WhatsApp and all this e-teaching mode. They can very much, and I always interact by chat mode. They answer it, I question it, they answer it, and in that way, it is possible. It is not in that way, but always we feel something that in the classroom, that environment we are missing. That pain is there all the time.
So do you think that mechanisms for giving number to final semester undergraduate students is appropriate?
Mechanism for?
Giving number to final semester undergraduate students is appropriate.
Mechanism for final? No, I am missing.
Sir, the question is, do you think that the mechanisms for giving number to final semester undergraduate students is appropriate?
Oh, that number, what marks? Marks, yeah. Marks, giving marks to the student. Actually, it is not appropriate. It is in the situation, this is the only way to help the students. Otherwise, students would get no results. Many of them have got job. So once they get certain results, they can at least accept the job. And there is one option is given, that afterwards, when they can give exam in the physical mode, they can opt for that. So for the time being, when there is no exam, physical mode exam can be organized, if university can organize that, that would be also not very much good policy in this situation. Because if any, in any center, suppose out of 200 students sitting for examination, one day they have given examination, next day we found that one of them has got this disease, then entire center would be cancelled. Then what would happen to other students? So this kind of situation should be avoided. So certain marks is given, and I find okay, based on the past marks, whatever maximum marks is allotted to them, they are not getting anything for the final year. They are only assessed to the extent of 20%. So for final year preparation, you are rewarded by 20%, and for 80% you are getting reward for your past performance. That is not appropriate, but in this situation, that is the only thing, one acceptable thing. We also suggested, we are also in this, whatever decision has been taken by the government, actually we have been asked to give our suggestions. Accordingly, we have given suggestions, and based on those suggestions, ultimately they have combined, and this kind of decision has been, order has been passed.
The next one is, online education system is very useful for today, but do you think this online mode of education system increase the system of open education or not?
open education, yes, open education is good thing. It is not bad thing, but it doesn't prevent that who have enrolled, they would get it. And they are connected to certain college and universities because there would be certain offline classes also with that university and colleges. You think of the Chartered Institute or Cost Institute. They are organizing certain classes. They are organizing online classes. They are organizing physical mode classes. And some students may not go for classes and give directly examination without attending many more classes. So there are study materials. Going through the study materials, the exam system is there. And that exam system is not online, physical mode exam system. And that is taken. So in that way, daily classes are avoided most of the time by this Chartered Institute, Cost Institute, Company Secretaryship. But still, when you are a student of Chartered Institute, you have to be connected. It is not open for all this course material. It is not open for any students, any person. You have to enroll there and then you access to this, all these facilities, etc. So it may be a part of it, may be open for others, but some major part would be restricted to those who are enrolled, who have enrolled.
How accounting classes can be taken effectively and interestingly? From where I will get the videos you stated?
Yes, accounting classes are difficult to take. You have to prepare videos, actually. You have to develop, the teachers have to develop videos. Where using whiteboard, using blackboard, they would develop some video classes and that they would distribute to their students. So that type of camera and sound system must be at home also of the teachers, so that they suppose in the background there is one board and I am doing this, and I used to take some classes on that, video classes. So that I find that is helpful, because the students, if their record is there, student can play the record once and one and more repeatedly, and then one point it is not understood, they can understand after repeating several times. And if there is still question, then there is certain online classes, there is chatting and there is other connections, they can clear it. So it can be done, but not as fluently, as easily, as happily as in done in the classrooms. Because in the classrooms, there are direct contact. And for that reason, there is good understanding. And it is all indirect. All these indirect methods, there are certain test feeling is low in this indirect process. But still, it can be done by using videos. You have to put on your blackboard, use your chalk and talk and show the videos. Chalk and talk is continuing through videos. That can be done online. So we are not avoiding chalk and talk. Chalk and talk is not avoided, but that is done through videos.
Do you think virtual education will be popular in future in our country?
Yes, it would be popular. Virtual education would be popular because there would be certain cost advantage. Because for virtual education, cost would be minimum. If the institution is not making huge profit, it can be given at a very low cost. And I think these reading materials would be given free. So it would be almost free. So this virtual education would be popular.
The next question is, sir, as per your valuable suggestion, is there any model type of education system we can start or follow for the next upcoming students in the colleges? Can you suggest any model for the online education?
No, I have not yet developed any model like that. What I do or practice, that is my experience, but I have not developed any model. I cannot suggest any model, because any one model is not suitable for all type of classes. So for every subject, there may be a different mode of teaching. It requires something different. So in that way, not one model would be sufficient. There had to be alternative different models suitable for different subjects, different classes of students, different levels of students. That is, suppose for primary students, what model is effective. For secondary students, another model would be effective. For higher education, another model would be effective. For PhD students, another model would be effective. So there would be multiple model, multiple approaches, and different languages, different techniques should be used. It would be a comprehensive, a consolidated thing, that consolidation of many, many models.
Do you think every educational institution must consider online teaching platform in their business community program?
In their business community program, educational institution, how, what type of business community? Let me be clear. Business community, is it?
Yes, yes, sir. That's what it's written here. This is from Kaushik Pal. Do you think every educational institution must consider online teaching platform in their business, sorry, continuity program, business continuity program?
Yes, that can be done for their business also. This online teaching, just universities, they, that's distance learning, that is one mode, and that is very much cash rich programs, because from that distant education program they can fetch some money, the fund is good. So from business point of view, this distant remote education is always financially strong, because if you, the cost per student, suppose ₹1, if you charge ₹10, then there would be ₹9 surplus, but that ₹10, it would be even very small to the students if in comparison to any physical mode learning process. So in that way, it is, from business point of view, it is okay, acceptable. How to conduct practical classes, is that someone question? Sabir Rahman. Sabir Rahman, how to conduct practical classes of physics and chemistry in online mode? No, it is not possible. Practical classes have to be, physical presence is required. That I found from US and European, their education plans and policies, they have said that practical classes, physical mode is required, practical classes. Practical cannot be online.
So there is a question that, sir, God forbid, if this situation continues for 2 or 3 more years, won't it be too late to start classes then? Online teaching can be cheaper than usual mode. For example, if we take travel cost to the institution to be ₹30 to and fro for a year for 200 days out of 365 days, brings the cost to 6,000. Mobiles are now cheaper than that. If we can watch YouTube and access social media, we can also access education. Sir, what are your views?
Yes, it is cheap and it is effective, but it is not that much interesting, because this class experience is rather, and those who stay in hostel, in university premises or college premises, in hostel, and their 3 years, 4 years, their lifetime experience, that would be lost. You are at your home and you are feeling, you may feel bored, but if you are focused, you can learn more, and it is also cheap, and it is, certain cases, it is also advantageous all the way, advantageous. From time point of view, you require less time, your this coming to the college or returning to your home, this time would not be, that time would be saved, money would be saved, and you would get many resources, much more resources, because in class there is limited resources. But in online, you would get unlimited resources. Many solutions, many questions, many materials you can access, and you can judge which one you would take. So there are many positive sides also.
Students of primary section also are attending online classes through mobile device of 7 classes per day with 20 minutes break only. Is it justice to them? peace process
no it is not justice to them. Not more than 2 hours at a stretch should we give the students or children should not be compelled to go for more than 2 hours at a stretch. 2 hours, then half hour break, again 2 hours, that can be done. But you know, our education system is not that much. In our certain countries, the government employees have to work for 4 days, 6 hours a day. They thought that this should be sufficient for highest productivity. Can we think of that? 4 days, 6 hours a day? Never. We say 9 hours a day, 10 hours a day, 12 hours. In the IT sector, they are forcing them to 12 hours a day and 5 days. That kind of thing for the students also. Our good students are actually our, we are called, already mentioned many times, that this happens, that this is not good, but this is our education administrators are doing that. They are all the time pressurizing the students with huge and huge syllabuses and coverage and more hours. They should be not more than 4 or 5 hours. They should be total time in the day they should give for the education. But that is not in our country. That is not going. And that thing is continuing. Okay.
The next question is, do you think online education can replace the classroom environment?
Never it can replace the classroom environment. Environment you would be losing, but some other benefits you may get, but environment you would be losing. Never you would get classroom environment. That is a loss, irreparable loss.
Virtual education is popular in case of professional education, even in accounting classes. Do you agree, sir?
Yes, in accounting and finance classes, I know virtual education is very much popular, and that is going on, because in most of the CA and costing, you find virtual education is more rather than physical mode education, conventional education. So it is popular there. But there is no such classroom environment, and the students do not enjoy that environment ever. They have no experience of enjoying that. Whenever I have done my CA, I have done my commerce education. In commerce education, I am in the Goenka college classes, in university classes. That is something, classroom environment. I have never thought of any such classroom environment. I have no such feeling about that CA. That course should be completed and marks should be secured. That is the goal, and there is no such enjoying the time. But we all who have spent our college days and university days, we enjoyed the time. That environment, enjoying that environment, classroom environment, that would be totally missing. But that doesn't mean that CA students or costing students, they have not thought of that environment while they are pursuing their courses. They thought that they have to complete the course and get the result. That was their objective, and that has been fulfilled.
How to do the activities through online classes, sir?
How to
do the activities?
Do the activities.
Activities through online classes.
How to do the activities through online classes, sir? Activities. Skip that question. Then I didn't understand what type of activities.
Okay. I think that is the last one.
Okay.
I can't see any more question in the chat box. If you feel asking any question to Professor Pal, please unmute yourself and ask directly. I think there is no other question in the chat box. If you have any question, probably I may have missed out some of the questions in the chat box. If you have any other questions that has not been, you can please unmute yourself and ask. Okay, I think there is no other question. So before going to the vote of thanks, I just want to make an announcement that feedback form has already been shared in the chat box for several times. I request the participants to please fill up the feedback form. The feedback form will be open until 9:30 p.m. today. So you have to fill the feedback form up within 9:30 p.m. tonight. And this is necessary for generating e-certificates. So please do fill up the feedback form. So first, I'd like to thank our honorable speaker, Dr. Anandu Mohan Pal, for this wonderful session. And he has, despite his busy schedule, has found time to grace this session. We are extremely grateful to you, sir. And I extend my thanks to our principal, sir, for all possible support and encouragement he has extended to us. I owe my heartiest gratitude to all distinguished IQAC members without whose support this program has not been successful. My heartfelt thanks to all my colleagues and friends present over here. Finally, on behalf of Domdom Motijil Robindra Mahavidyalaya, I would like to express my appreciation to all the participants for taking time out of their busy schedule to attend this webinar. So thank you for your attention. Thank you all. So one small announcement that we are organizing an international webinar on 3rd of July. Topic is disinformation and online radicalization. Dr. Shongita Mahapatra, Research Associate, German Institute of Global and Area Studies, Hamburg, Germany, has agreed to speak on that day. So we cordially invite all of you in that webinar. And we also are organizing another webinar. This will be organized by Department of Education in collaboration with IQAC. This will be on coping with stress and managing education in the context of COVID-19 pandemic, the whole institutional approach. Dr. Mrinal Mukherjee, Assistant Professor and Coordinator, Department of Educational Planning and Administration, the West Bengal University of Teachers Training, Education Planning and Administration, Kolkata, has given his kind consent to speak in the webinar. So we cordially invite all of you on both of the days. Please join with us. So thank you once again for being with us. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Pal. Can we end this session, sir?
Yes, very much.
Yes. I'm asking Principal, sir, please. Sir, can we end this session? Sir? Okay, so we are ending this session. Thank you.
Thank you all.